You know, I don't want to go in too much of that in this video. This is a this is a pen video, for crying out loud. So that's a nice little reflection, kind of a reddish reflection. Hey everybody. I don't know about you, but where I am, it's cold outside. And this Zippo lighter now that it's nice and warm, feels kind of good to hold. I've had this lighter for a good many years. Yeah, I did the engraving on it myself. You can probably tell. Now, some time back, I did a video on this this pen. This is a Jinhao 100. It's a beautiful pen. It's a great pen. I've really enjoyed it. Now, Jinhao is a well, it's a Chinese pen company, and they're pretty good at copycatting or knocking off other brands of pens. The Jinhao 100 is, of course, what this is a knockoff of a Parker Dufold Centennial. Now, the Dufold Centennial made by Parker would cost you several hundred dollars. Probably $800, maybe $900. But this pen looks like it, and it writes like a dream. And even though at this moment I'm I can't remember exactly how much this cost. I'll put it up on the screen right about now. But as you can see, it's a lot less than the Parker, and it looks just as good, if not better. Now, I don't have anything against the Parker. I would love to have one. But the truth is, that's a lot of money. That's a lot of money for a pen. I do have a Dufold Junior, vintage 1926. And you can see the similarities in the design. The Parker Dufold Junior is a smaller pen. That's why they call it a Junior. So it's not as big as a Centennial. So Jinhao did a really, really nice job of making a copy of that Parker Dufold Centennial. Hold on just a second. I gotta wet my whistle. This is a vintage Parker 51. Now, some of you know just how special and important and I'm drawing a blank on what I want to say. Parker pushed the envelope back in the late 30s. When the 51 came out. This particular example, I think, is a 1952 or maybe a 1949. I can't remember, but the nib, which is the part made of gold that the ink flows through, is they call it a hooded nib because it's only slightly exposed. Unlike, I think I can show you, unlike a traditional fountain pen, the nib is completely exposed. Like, look at this big old whopping gold plated nib. Yeah, I did say gold plated. For the price of this pen, you're not gonna get a solid gold nib like you would with a Parker Centennial. I mean, even this hooded nib is solid gold. So when Parker came out with this pen, it was groundbreaking. And I've done a video on the 51, so I'm not going to go rehash all of that. But the point is, someone is always trying to make a knockoff of the Parker 51. Here's a pretty good knockoff. This is a Hero 100. H-E-R-O. Hero 100. And as you can see, it too has the hooded nib, and it's very similar, in shape. You know, the profile of the tip is, it's pretty much the same as the Parker 51. Now, this is a Hero 100. It's not a Jinhao, but it's a good writer, and it cost a fraction of a vintage Parker 51. Now, Jinhao also copycatted the 51, and they called it their Jinhao 51A. I mean they almost copycatted the name. I mean, they just put a letter A. And in this package, I have two of them. I've not removed them from the package yet. So in a future video, we're going to take these out and look at these and compare them against a vintage 51. But that's for another time. So, you know, the vintage 51, obviously, they stopped making it many decades ago. But in 2021, Parker released a pen. It's a Parker 51 reissue. And I purchased one in... many of you have seen the video that I made about this pen. This pen turned out to be a nice pen. I like it. I like it a lot. The hooded nib is not exactly the same as the original Parker 51. It's still a hooded nib, but it is different. And you can go back and watch that video, and you can see why it's different. But the finish on this one is called plum. I know it looks black. I don't know. Black. Maybe you can see a difference in this black wooden handle of this brush. Speaking of a brush, let's do some traditional ASMR brushing. That's enough of that. And this cap on this Parker is gold. It's gold plated. I don't think it's solid. I don't really recall. But yeah, I did a video on this and I really did like it. Well, in true Jinhao form, they copied this Parker 51 reissue. Parker announced that they were going to make this reissue 51. They announced it in 2019, and it was 2021 when they released it. But believe it or not, Jinhao came out with a pen that looks like this. It was a copy of this. They came out with theirs in 2020. It's crazy how fast. Parker announced in 2019 they would come out with this pen. In a year later, a year before Parker actually came out with this pen, Jinhao beat them to the punch. They beat them to the punch with what's inside of this box. Move some things out of the way. Now this is a Jinhao 85. Yes, 85. Jinhao 85. And it's a retro reissue look of the Parker 51. And it's got a fine nib. And it's made out of the barrel is made out of wood. Yeah. They did make some metal barrel 85s, but this one is wood. Now, I have not inked this pen. I was saving that for this video. Some of you might wonder why I use a knife to open this. I'm just trying to take care of the packaging. I'll set the box off to the side. And this comes in a nice, clear plastic box. And here's a little bit of a fountain pen care guide. It's pretty generic. It's not specific to this pen. A nice little polishing cloth. Here's the pen itself. Wow, would you look at that? That's beautiful. And look, they even have in the Parker arrow clip. You know, it's, if you don't know, the pocket clips on the Parkers are generally in the shape of an arrow. They got the point, and they have what are like feathers up here. That's a better view of it. So here on the left is the Parker. the Jinhao looks to be just a tad bit longer. But and the cap is gold in color, but it's not gold plated, I don't think. I think it's brass. And the Parker cap on the left is gold plated. The ribbing, yeah, the Parker has these fine ribs. Well, they're not quite as fine on the Jinhao. But they're still there. There's an amazing similarity with the tops of the cap. Cap screws off just like on the Parker. Let me move the Zippo. And again, you see some similarities. The profile of the tips of the pins are the same. And the nibs are rather similar. There's the difference in uncapped length. Yeah, that much. I do like this blue. I had a Fender Stratocaster guitar that was about this color. I had a friend back in the 80s that had a Chevrolet Z28 Camaro that was close to this color. It's a really pretty pin. But let's see if it writes as well as a Parker. Let's ink it up, shall we? Now this pen came with a bottle of ink. It also came with two ink cartridges. And they appear to be blue. but we're going to use the bottled ink. It's in a nice glass jar. Black plastic cap. It's got some nice, looks like a some type of flower. Rose. I don't know. The ink itself, obviously it's going to be blue. It's 15 milliliter bottle. It just says Jinhao on it. I'm going to turn that mic up for just a second so you can hear me shake the ink. Now, you don't have to shake fountain pen ink. I only do it because I like the sound. No other reason. We're going to take the cap off. Now, generally, it's not a bad idea to wash. To wash a new pen in some soapy, some mild soapy water, and rinse it off just to get any oily residues that might be on the pen from manufacturing. Many times I do that, and, you know, sometimes I don't. And here's a nice ink converter. An ink converter is just a reservoir to hold the ink. It has a little rubber plunger. Some people call it a piston. And you can see when I screw, when I twist the end of the converter, the piston moves back and forth. And it comes out just like that. So instead of a pre-filled cartridge, you can get a converter and fill it yourself with any kind of ink that you wish to use. Now, before we put the ink into the pen, I've got some Kleenex. It'll be good to have one of those handy. I'll just put this piece of felt right here. That's pretty nice looking. I like it. So this is how it's going to go down. I'm going to put the plunger all the way to the top. Then we're going to dip the pen into the bottle up to about here. Then I'll make the plunger go down, which will expel the air. And then I'll twist it all the way to the top, and it will draw some ink up into it. And then I'll go back down one more time, and then back up one more time. And that should give us plenty of ink. So, here we go. I'm going to turn the mic up so maybe you can hear what's happening here. Now, I'm going to carefully move the ink away and get my Kleenex, my tissue. And I'm just rotating the pen in the tissue. Trying my best not to get ink on myself. Now I'm going to lay the pen down. And before I do anything else, I'm going to put the cap on the bottle. Because you do not want to spill fountain pen ink. If you spill a bottle of fountain pen ink, it will ruin your day. Take the barrel, which is this part, and screw it on to this part, which is called the section. And there's threads right here. I'm trying to figure out if those are plastic. Gosh, those feel like they might be plastic, but I'm not sure. Surely not. The price of this pen, I haven't told you yet, and I'll put it on the screen right now, right about here. Let's put the cap on it. And get some paper. I tell you what, before we write with it, let's see how much it weighs in ounces. .9 ounces. Now, how does that compare with the Parker Reissue 51? .8 ounces. Now, there is not any ink in the Parker. Whether that's enough to account for 0.1 ounces, I wouldn't think so, but I'm not sure. No, I don't think so. The part of the pen that you hold, if you're curious, and I know I am, measures 0.04 inches. Now, I live in the United States, and even though we use metric for a lot of things, we are still firmly entrenched in imperial measurements. You know, inches, feet, yards, miles, that kind of thing. Now I can convert that. I can take 0.402 and multiply that by 25.4 to get millimeters. Now on the Parker, it measures the same. 402. Wow. They really did copy it right here above the threads. We're right here at the right where the threads are. 453 thousandths of an inch. On the Jinhao, I wouldn't be surprised if it's the same. .454 inches. That's only 1/1 of an inch difference. If you're wondering how much is 1/1 of an inch, well, a typical human hair is 3 to 4 thousandths of an inch. So that kind of tells you it's not much. I wonder if the Jinhao cap will screw onto the Parker. No, I don't think it will. And you don't want to force it, because you don't want to mess the threads up. So will the Parker cap screw onto the Jinhao? No, not really. The thread's inside the cap. It's a little bit larger diameter on the Parker. So let's set the Parker off to the side. Get a little piece of cat hair or something in there. I need another sip of this wine. That's good. I have some paper here, and it is Clairefontaine. Okay. It's 50 sheets. It's a fountain pen. Yeah, it's fountain pen friendly. So this will be the first time that I write with this pen. Now generally I like to write with my caps posted. Posted means that you put the cap on the end of the pen. Of course, that makes it longer. But it kind of, it changes the balance of the pen. And some caps on some pens post more securely than they do on others. The inside threads of the cap appear to be plastic, I think, so they don't seem to scratch the finish on the wood barrel. Okay, now let's take a look here. I'm going to zoom in a little bit here. I'm also going to reset the focus. I don't use autofocus on my camera because my microphones are so sensitive that they can pick up the sound of the electronics within the camera that control the focusing. This is a fine nib. And it certainly feels like a fine, because a fine nib is the surface that touches the paper is so much less than a medium nib that there's a little bit more what they call toothiness. It kind of grabs just a little bit more than a medium nib would. It's not too bad. Just making some letters. It writes pretty well, right out of the box. Usually after you ink a fountain pen, you can start writing with it, but as you write with it, you actually notice that it becomes smoother and wetter. And what I mean by wet is it's basically the amount of ink that the pen lays down on the paper. So if I make a mark like, say like this, and then immediately drag my hand across, my finger across it, the distance from here to here kind of gives you an idea of how wet the pen is. If it streaks, if the streak was longer, you would know that there's more ink on the paper. So let me write with this, and we'll come back up and do that again. I'm going to take the cap off of it, unpost the cap, and try writing with it like that. Now it feels like it's actually losing some ink, like a nib is drying out or the feed. Let's draw another line. And you can see that it actually is drier now. So what I'm going to do is unscrew the barrel. And I'm going to take a tissue just in case anything drips. I'm going to twist I'm going to twist this and make the plunger go down just a little bit. We're actually forcing some of that ink into the feed. And you can see the tissue caught a drop of ink. We'll put the cap back on. We'll try the line again up here. We'll see how this does. It definitely feels wetter. Too shabby. I'm going to turn the mic up so you can hear some writing noises. Maybe. Thank you. having a hard time writing tonight. Sometime I should just do a video of nothing but writing. Before I cap it, let's go back up and do this wetness test again. So it hasn't changed much. I'd say the more I wrote with it, the smoother, the better it felt. There's not any flex to speak of. If there was flex, your downstroke would be wider than the upstroke, but or a side stroke. But here's a downstroke. Here's the side stroke. There's an upstroke. They're all about the same. Let's see what it does on just regular paper. I've got this little memo notebook. Now, last night I was doing a manual band scan on an AM radio. I was looking to see how far out the radio could pull stations. Or better yet, at nighttime, the AM signals tend to travel further. Maybe during the day, an AM signal might be 100 miles at best. But at nighttime, because of some changes in the atmosphere, the ionosphere to be more specific, the AM radio signals can travel hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles. So last night I was listening to, let's see, WBAP AM 820. And that station is out of Fort Worth, Texas. Is there a hyphen between Fort and Worth? I don't know. Fort Worth, Texas. And, you know, they're a 50,000 watt Class A clear channel station. 50,000 watts. Or you could say 50 kilowatts, same thing. Now, I was also pulling in a station out of Louisville, Kentucky, called WHAS. WHAS. AM 840. Louisville, Kentucky. And they're a 50,000-watt Class A clear channel station. They're actually the oldest broadcasting radio station in Kentucky. They got their license and first went on the air in 1922. And I was pulling in WWL AM 870 out of New Orleans. Yeah. How do you spell that? New Orleans. Louisiana. Is that right? LA? Is that the abbreviation for Louisiana? Or is it LS? I think it's LA. But I could be wrong. It's one of those things you don't have to write it much. And if you don't live there, you know, you just... I was also pulling in on the radio last night. WLS AM. 890 out of Chicago. Chicago, Illinois. Yeah. I remember when I was just a kid laying in bed with a little transistor radio listening to WLS. Did that all the time. I don't think it was 890 when I was a kid. I think it changed, but I could be wrong. I'm not sure. It's a great station. It's another 50,000 watt powerhouse. And WSM. I was pulling that in out of Nashville, Tennessee last night. It's AM 650. Nashville, Tennessee. That station has been, they got licensed back in 1925. So these stations, they were coming in nice and clear. And, you know, it's something about listening to an AM radio. It's, you know, I don't want to go into much of that in this video. This is a, this is a pen video, for crying out loud, so... that's a nice little reflection, kind of a reddish reflection. And maybe I can do a radio video, do some band scanning, but I'm not sure how I could make that relaxing. So back to the pen, you can see that there's no bleed, what you call bleed through. You know. So the pen wasn't writing so wet that it just bleeds through to the other side. Because quite honestly, this paper in this notebook is not that good. Let's do our test again. I wouldn't say it was dry, but it's definitely not wet either. But then again, you have to remember it's a fine nib. Not very much surface touching the paper. I have another type of paper. It's made out of stone. Paper is smoother and water resistant when using a ballpoint pen. It's water and tear resistant. Made from stone, not paper pulp. As far as the way this pen feels, I like it. It feels great. I've got the Parker 51 reissue in my hand. And they feel the same. You know, they're the same as they should, because they're the same diameter where you hold them at. Most people hold the pen down here, low. I kind of move up just a little bit. I kind of hold mine a little higher. And because of that, oftentimes I'm holding across the band. And some pens have a pretty smooth transition from size from here to here. You can kind of see that it's not too bad on these pens. On some pens, the transition is rather abrupt, steep. And those pens aren't as comfortable for me to hold on to. I don't like the way that the nib feels on this paper. It really bites. Not, you know, that doesn't mean what some people think it means. It is a negative thing, actually. It's the pen is kind of toothy, and the paper feels kind of, there's too much resistance. and resistance is an important thing when it comes to pens, but too much resistance isn't good. Not enough resistance isn't good. Some pens, especially rollerball pens, which I do have quite a few new ones I need to show you, but some of them are so slippery. It's like driving on ice. You can't control your letters and stuff quite as well as you can with a fountain pen. You need some feedback when you're writing, and you only get the feedback from friction. But with too much friction, it's hard to form the letters because the pen is kind of grabbing. Anyway, this video has been going on long enough. If you're a Patreon supporter of mine, I don't tell you often enough how much I appreciate you. And just the regular viewers that are not patrons, I appreciate you guys also. And hope everyone likes what I do here on this channel. Sometimes I feel like I'm maybe boring everybody with these quiet little pursuits that I do for relaxation. But if you do enjoy it, please, if you're able to, click the thumbs up button. I know it's hard. I don't think you can do it if you're watching YouTube on a smart TV. I don't know if you can do that. But if you're watching it on your computer or your smartphone, please give me a like, because that does indeed help move the channel in a positive direction. So, can't think of anything else to say. Disappointed that the Packers did not make it to the Super Bowl. But that's okay. Life goes on. Everything will be fine. Just remember, just try to be calm. Everything's going to work out. So take care.